Let's turn into our Bibles to the book of Luke. Luke chapter 2, the voice in the wilderness. John's birth was one of divine providence. Here was a young man who was born into a family that had no hope of having a family. Father named Zacharias, a priest. A mother named Elizabeth, who was considered barren because of her age and having no children. And yet God visited Zacharias in his faithfulness there in the temple as he was placing incense, burning incense upon the altar of God, more than likely praying for his wife, praying for himself, praying for the nation of Israel and the people. And there the angel Gabriel met with him and told him that God had heard his prayers, that they were going to have a son. And so we see a very unusual conception, a very unusual birth. But you know, there were many in the Bible that had this same type of story. We have Hannah and the whole story of Samuel. We have the story of Sarah and Abraham. All of these people, folks, were beyond the age of birthing, and yet God moved with his hand of grace and mercy. So we see that John's birth was one of divine providence. God interceded and brought to this family one called John, who would be known as John the Baptist. We see John's ministry as one of purpose, but his ministry was one of divine prophecy. He was foretold by the prophets of old. There in Isaiah chapter 40, Isaiah had seen in a vision. In verse 3, he said, "The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God." The Isaiah prophecy of the book of Isaiah spoke of a messenger coming, one who would come and would prepare the way of the Messiah. John was that one by divine prophecy. Malachi 3:1, the prophet Malachi, everyone says, you hear the word Malachi, everybody thinks of tithing, of giving money. But you know, Malachi had more than just talking about tithing. He had a prophecy in verse 1 of chapter 3 of Malachi. He says, "Behold, I send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple, even the messenger of the covenant, in whom you delight. Behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts." So we see that the prophets spoke of John the Baptist. There was a divine prophecy from more than one prophet speaking of the ministry of John the Baptist, this child who was born to an elderly couple, a couple who had given up on the fact of having a child, given up on having a family. In verse 1 and 2 of the political world of John, we see a world of trouble, a world of tragedy, a world of turmoil, but also a world of timing too. The Bible says in Galatians 4, verse 4 and 5, "But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons." The Bible says in Galatians that the timing of Christ's birth was right on time. It was according to God's purpose. He was sent forth at the fullness of time. But yet, if you would pick a time for a child to be born, this would not be the time. Many people perhaps today would think in this world in which we live, a world of tragedy, a world of turmoil, a world of trouble, that this would be the worst time to have a child. We are much like the time of the Roman. In fact, the Bible says that in the last days there will be a revival of the old Roman Empire. And we see that today in our news. We see that today in our papers and on the internet. How we live in a world of trouble, tragedy, and turmoil. But there's going to come a time, and Jesus is coming soon. Oh, beloved, we must understand that it is the timing of God. We see in chapter 3, we're going to look at verses 1 through 6. Let's take it starting with verse 1. Now in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, we have a new Caesar, used to be Augustus. Augustus brought the family down from Nazareth to Bethlehem. Now we see a new Caesar. The reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate being governor of Judea, Herod being tetrarch of Galilee, his brother Philip tetrarch of Iturea and the region of Trachonitis, and Licinius the tetrarch of Abilene. While Annas and Caiaphas were high priests, the word of God came to John, the son of Zacharias, in the wilderness. And he went into all the region around Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill brought low. The crooked places shall be made straight, and the rough ways smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of the Lord. We see in verse 1 a bringing of a leadership of Rome. The Bible begins by giving us the leaders of that time of John and Jesus as they began to come into their public ministry. As John began to baptize there in the Jordan, we see by historical references to these people about the timing. This was a historical truth. This was not something that somebody just made up. This was not a bedtime story. This was true historical fact. And the great writer Luke, who was a doctor who wrote many wonderful things about the physiological aspects of Jesus' teaching and his ministry, also was showing us historical facts that Jesus and John were of true historical aspect here in the land of Israel. In verse 1, we see the leadership of Rome. The identity of the Caesar was Tiberius. Tiberius was a man chosen by God for this time, just as Augustus was chosen by God for his time to bring Joseph and Mary down from Nazareth to Bethlehem, that child, according to the prophetic teachings of the prophets, that the Messiah would be born in Bethlehem. He too was a man chosen by God for this time. Daniel chapter 4 and verse 17 says, this decision is by the decree of the watchers and the sentence by the word of the holy ones, in order that the living may know that the Most High rules in the kingdoms of men, gives it to whomever he will, and sets over it the lowest of men. The Bible says in Daniel that God brings into power men and women who need to be there according to his will. In the book of Daniel, we see how Daniel shows about these five great kingdoms that were coming, these five great men that he would be in charge of these kingdoms, and how God would bring them into play. And folks, I believe that God is still in the kingdom-making business. Now, this was also a scripture text that they used, the divine rights of the kings back in the Middle Ages. Many of the kings and queens would determine that they had complete rule over the people by the divine right of kings. But what we see is God brings them into focus so that they would do the will of God, whether they realize it or not, whether they're a believer or not. So we see that our leaders are provoked and given their positions, even to the lowest of men, Daniel says, they would be brought into place. So we see Tiberius. He was the stepson of Caesar Augustus. He reigned from 14 AD to 37 AD. Very unpopular. Very unpopular. People of Rome did not like him. He was extremely perverted and cruel and very, very brutal. He would basically do things that were absolutely could not be said, could not be talked about, could not be shared in this time, in this place, mixed company. It was recorded that when he died in 37 AD, that most of the Romans danced in the streets. He was sent off into exclusion by his own self on the island of Capri. There he turned it into a horrible, horrible place, a place of torture, a place of cruelty, a place of perversion. So we see that even God brings into this world and this place even people who are of the lowest of men, the Bible says. And then we see also, not was he a man chosen by God, but he was a man cursed by God. And why was he cursed by God? Because he hated the Jews. He, in fact, expelled the Jews from Rome at one time. Before they were allowed back in, he hated the Jews. He did everything he could to try to destroy the Jewish people. Much like Antiochus Epiphanes, when the Greeks were in charge, the Greco-Syrians were in charge of Israel at that time. Much like Antiochus Epiphanes, he was a hater of the Jewish people, a hater of the Jewish faith, a hater of the Jewish God. We see he was a man cursed by God. Why? Because the promise of the Abrahamic covenant was simple. The Bible said to Abraham, I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you, and through you all the earth shall be blessed. Oh, folks, this man who turned against the Jewish people, against the God of the Jewish people, was a man who was on a headlong target of hell. And let me say this to you, this man has been in hell for thousands of years. I can't imagine the tragedy of a man like this. And so we see Tiberius Caesar. We see him in time and in space. He was taking up the mantle of heathenism in the time of John and Jesus. Next, we see the intermediates of Caesar. We see the governor, Pontius Pilate. You know, for years, the critics of the Bible said that Pilate never existed, that historically there is no proof that he ever existed. If he was a man who was in charge of Israel at that time, you would think he would be in all these different papers. But you see, when you got out of favor with Caesar, they tended to erase you from history. It was like the Egyptians who literally would take their chisels and chisel your names and positions out of stone. They would chisel it away from the stone. But you see, back in 1960, there were two discoveries, one up by Caesarea, the other down by the Herodias, down by Bethlehem, that talked about Pilate of Rome, who was in charge of Israel. And then we find in the Herodias a signet ring that was used for the sealing of documents that had Pontius Pilate on it. And so we see that the spade of the archaeologists once more gives us an indication saying that though they said no, God said, my Bible is true. So we see the governor Pilate, he was the longest ruler from Rome. He ruled for 10 years from 26 AD to 36 AD. He antagonized the Jewish people. He too did not like the Jewish people. He would do things purposely to get them upset. Again, he was like Antiochus Epiphanes. He wanted them to become Roman citizens and get away from all this Jewish filth, he would believe. We see that this man of Rome was a hater of Jewish people too. You know, a lot of people would say that he was not the one that the Bible talked about. He was frightened. He was even trying not to condemn Jesus, but he did, found him innocent three times, but yet condemned him to death because he feared the people. He feared the rulers of Rome. And so we see that he presided over Christ's death. A tragic man, a tragic person. In 38 or 39 AD, he was called back to Rome. There, according to tradition, he lived up in the north part, up by the Alps mountains, either in Switzerland or there by at the northern part of Italy. And there, in that place, he committed suicide. What a tragedy for Pilate. Then we see the Tetrarch Herod. Now, this is Herod Antipas. This is not Herod the Great. This is the son of Herod the Great. Herod died about 4 BC, and this is where Herod Antipas came into power. He was called a tetrarch. Now, a tetrarch was a ruler, what it literally means, a ruler over a quarter. And what they did with Herod's kingdom was that they split it in four different sections, one being Judea, another, and we see, I'll talk a little bit about some of the others, but their Pilate was in charge of Judea. But here we see that Herod Antipas ruled over the Galilee region. He had the rulership of the land where John and Jesus did most of their ministries. Herod would have heard of them. In fact, Herod heard of John the Baptist very much, because it was John the Baptist who preached against Herod Antipas, saying that he was wrong, that he had literally had gone against God's law by marrying the wife of his half-brother, Philip. So we see that he was there in the Galilee area from 4 BC to about 39 AD. He had John the Baptist beheaded for what he preached. He preached against sin very hard. He preached against the sin of Herod very openly and publicly. And Herod said, well, I can't have that. And so he had John arrested, and his wife Herodias had him beheaded. And so we see that he and John were well known to each other. He built the city of Tiberias. He was like his father. Now, his father built great cities. He built some of the wonderful cities of Israel. In fact, he was very instrumental. His father, Herod the Great, began to rebuild the temple of Israel, refurbish it. And lo and behold, it wouldn't even finish till after Jesus had died on the cross. But we see here that Herod Antipas built this city and literally named it after the Caesar. It was a political ploy, trying to earn some brownie points with the Caesar, because Herod Antipas and his brothers were only in those positions because Caesar wanted them to be there. Herod was not a Jew. Herod the Great was not Jewish. He was an Edomian, an Edomite. And therefore, he got in power because he married one of the Hasmonean's daughters who was there with the Maccabees. And so he married a good Jewish girl, made great political connections, and went to Rome, and Rome made him king. And so these men were literally there as king because Rome determined it. The world determined it. But they didn't understand God allowed it. And so we see Herod Antipas. He would play a great, great part in this role of John the Baptist and the life of Jesus. In fact, he was in Jerusalem at the Passover when Jesus was condemned and tried, and Pontius Pilate decided, well, he's from Galilee. Let's send him to Herod. I don't want this problem. Let's give it to Herod. Herod can take care of it. When he went to Herod, all Herod said was, hey, I want you to perform a miracle. I want to see something to entertain me. And Jesus wouldn't do it. And so Herod sent him back to Pilate and dressed him up as a king, sent him back to Pilate. So we see that the tetrarch Herod Antipas had quite a bit of history in this time. Then there's the tetrarch Philip. Now he ruled over Etruria and Trachonitis. And there, those areas were just northeast of the Sea of Galilee. What we would call today the Golan Heights and southern Syria. And so that was the area that Philip had. Now, Philip ruled between 4 BC and 34 AD, and he married Salome. Now, Salome was the girl who danced at the party for Herod. She was the one who danced, and Herod said, I'll give you half of my kingdom for this dance. And Salome, through her mother's intervention, said, I'll have John the Baptist's head. This girl could have had half the kingdom. She could have had anything, but she wanted a Baptist preacher's head. Now, I'm telling you, there are people who are still headhunting, but the bottom line is very simple, folks. John may have lost his head at that time, but he gained eternity. And so we see Philip here, who's married to Salome, not one of a great background, by the way, the one who asked for John the Baptist's head. I hope Philip kept his very close to his shoulders, right? Then we see the tetrarch Lysanias. Now, little is known about him. He ruled the area of what the Bible calls Abilene, and that's not Texas, okay? It was an area northwest of Damascus, what we would call today modern Lebanon, not Texas. So don't get that confused, okay? So we see the intermediates of Caesar. Next, in verse 2, come the leadership of Israel. In verse 2, the first part, we see the high priest, plural, of Jerusalem. The Bible says, while Annas and Caiaphas were high priests. Now, there are people, again, who are critical, who say, you can't have two high priests at the same time. Technically, you can't. But, politically speaking, you can. For example, we have one president today who is at Washington, but we have many living presidents who have power, who have influence, and we see them today as they work around the political world. Annas was the father-in-law of Caiaphas. This high priest thing was not promoted by God. It was not promoted by the Sanhedrin. It was promoted by Rome. It was a political position more than a religious position. In fact, Annas maintained an entire family load of people that were high priests. His son John and Alexander all became high priests. And here we see Caiaphas, his son-in-law. Now, by the way, Caiaphas was, his name really was Joseph. Caiaphas was his Greek name, which says an awful lot about him. That, folks, we see him more of a Roman than he was a Jew. We see that he was more interested in finding favor among the Roman world than he would the Jewish world. The high priest Annas ruled between 6 AD and 15 AD, whereas Caiaphas ruled from 18 AD to 36 AD. Both were aligned with the Sadducees, which were a very liberal group and very, very important for the temple area. Now, also as high priest, both Annas and Caiaphas were chairman, acted as chairman of the Sanhedrin, the Jewish, what we would call the Supreme Court. And so we see that both of these men were very instrumental of their time. In fact, when Jesus was sent to Caiaphas for his trial, he was sent first to Annas. And there he was tried by Annas, who then sent him to Caiaphas. So we see that Annas still had some political power there in that time. And so we see again, the time period that all these men existed in the time of Jesus and John the Baptist, which gives us a historical reference for the ministry and the life of Jesus and John. Now, both Annas and Caiaphas were both involved in the illegal trial of Jesus and also with the arrests of Peter and John in Acts chapter 4. So not only did they have a touch in the life of Jesus, but they also had a touch in the early church. And so they were very instrumental in doing things that would prohibit them from loving God. Now, also in verse 2, we see the mention of John, the prophet of Jordan. We see him as the son of a priest, John, the son of Zacharias. Now, John had the credentials of a priest, but he had the calling of a prophet. John 1, verse 6 and 7 says, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. This man came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all through him might believe. John did not come to be a priest. He did not come to put incense on the altar. He did not come to put the animal sacrifices on the altar. He came to point to the Lamb of God who was to take away the sin of the world. That's why in John, the first chapter, John the Baptist introduces Jesus to everyone there. He says, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So John had the credentials of a priest, but he had the calling of a prophet. We see the sight of a prophet. Like all the prophets, he was in a place in the wilderness. He wasn't in the big city of Jerusalem. He left the environment of the temple. Oh, he was trained as a priest, folks. As a child, his father sent him to school, and he would have been trained as a priest. He would have known all the functions of the priesthood. He would have known all the prayers of the priesthood. He would have known of all the things that the priests would have had to have done. He understood not only the religious aspects of the priesthood, but he saw and understood the political aspects of the priesthood, how the high priests were nothing more than appointments of Rome. He understood that there was a great problem there among the Sadducees. They were very liberal. They didn't believe in the resurrection. They didn't believe in angels. They didn't believe in anything supernatural. And John, whose birth was supernatural, the conception birth was supernatural, he was to come and give a reference to one who not only was supernatural, but he was born of a virgin. Here was one who all his beliefs, everything about his life was counter to what the Sadducees, the priesthood, believed. And so we see, folks, that though he was a priest, he left the environs of the temple, went into the wilderness to assume the work of a prophet. The Bible says in verse 2, and the word of God came to John. That's very prophet. That's very prophet. The Bible many times begins the prophet's teachings and writings as, and the word of God came to Zechariah, or the word of God came to so-and-so, or whatever. And so, folks, we see that John is identified as the first prophet of the New Testament and the last prophet of the Old. So we see here a prophet of the Jordan. Now, in verse 3 through 6, we see the preaching word of John. We see, folks, the political world of John. We see the spiritual world of John. But now we're going to take a look at his preaching. In chapter 3, verse 3, we see a pleasing word of pardon. The Bible says in verse 3, and he went into all the region around the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the remission of sin. Now, it's a pleasing word of pardon because God was pleased by it. God was pleased that men had an opportunity to be saved. God was pleased that he brought Jesus at this time and at this place. God was pleased that he called John to be the prophet of the one who would be the voice crying in the wilderness. We see a public statement of repentance. His place of preaching was not in the synagogue. His place of preaching was not in the temple, but it was in the wilderness. The Bible again says in verse 3 that he'd gone to around the area of the Jordan. Now, the Jordan Valley area was about the western side of the boundary of Israel. And it is today the western side of the boundary of Israel. There he was sent to the Jordan River because there was a lot of water there, and he was baptizing. And the people would come from the Galilee area to John. The people would come from the Jerusalem area to be baptized by John. Oh, even the priests were sent by the high priest to determine what John was doing, if he was indeed the Messiah, or if he was causing trouble among the priest for the priesthood. We see his place of preaching. But next we see his point of preaching. And his point was to lead people to Christ and call people to repentance. In fact, that one word, repent, was his message. Repent, he said. Repent. So what is repentance? Repentance is, first of all, having the comprehension of knowing the need to repent. You know, the tragedy is not that we don't repent. The tragedy is not knowing what we need to repent. The Bible says that we ought to repent from our sins. And if we choose not to recognize those sins or push them far away, we are not repentant of our sins. And so John called the people of Israel to repentance. Why? Because the Messiah of God was coming and he was going to die for their sins. We see, first of all, there has to be a comprehension for repentance. You have to know you have a need to repent. You know, we're all born sinners. Every one of us. We are not sinners because we sin. Folks, listen, we all sin. The Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Everyone in this room, every child, every adult has been a sinner, has sinned. And oh, folks, the Bible says that the wages of sin is death. That's the problem. We're in the same boat. The problem is the boat's sinking. The only issue we have is we need a life preserver. And that life preserver is Jesus. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And so we see that we have to have the comprehension of the need for repentance. You see, I am not a sinner because I sin, but rather I sin because I was born a sinner. Next, we see confession. Repentance involves confession. You must confess to God, not to me or not to another man or not to another person, but to God. Yes, I am a sinner. When we confess to God that we are a sinner, when we confess our sins to Him, the Bible says He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So the second part of repentance is comprehension and confession. Next comes change. Next comes change. And what is that? Repentance means a change of direction. What we do is we see our sin for what it is. We choose to go a different direction. We choose to walk after the Lord. And so we see that when John said to the people of Israel, repent, he meant they had to understand they needed to repent, that they also needed to confess their sins and to change their life and walk a different direction. 2 Peter 3:9 says, the Lord is not slack concerning His promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. So we see here that John had a public statement of repentance. And then he had a public symbol of repentance in verse 3. The Bible says, preaching a baptism of repentance. Now this was a public profession. This was a profession. Baptism is the what I call the first work of repentance. When we come to understand that we need a Savior, when we come to understand that we need to be saved, and we invite Jesus into our heart, then we are a candidate for salvation, or excuse me, for baptism. We see that a public profession of repentance and receiving Christ is vitally important. Acts chapter 2, verse 41, Peter is preaching. The Bible says, then those who gladly received His word were baptized. And that day about 3,000 souls were added to Him. It was the right moment. It was after they were saved, after they received salvation, after they invited Jesus into their heart. Then they were baptized. And then the Bible says it was the right mode. They were immersed. John the Baptist immersed. That's what baptism in the Greek meant, to immerse, to be under the water. That's what a good Baptist does. We hold them there long enough. I told a lady one time, she was scared to death of water. I said, when your nose goes under, sister, you're coming up, okay? You got to go under. Then I had a lady who was a floater. I had to push her down. You got to go under. Got to go under. I went down and she just stopped. It was like, boom, and then she stopped. So I had to push her down, you know. Immersion is the way. Why? Because it is the right message. And what is that? We picture Jesus as He hung upon the cross when we stand in the water. When we go under the water, we picture the death and the burial of Jesus. And when we come up out of the water, thank God, we picture the resurrection. And so we see that there is a right moment after we're saved. There's a right mode, that is immersion, and then a right message of the death and resurrection of the Messiah. You see, what John was doing, he was preaching a sermon with what he was doing. He was telling people, repent. And then why would they repent? Because there's one coming who's going to die for you. He's going to be buried for you. He's going to rise for you. And if you believe it, then you'll follow Him in resurrection through the baptism. So we see a public profession and a personal possession. Listen, folks, you need to receive Jesus. The Bible says those who have Christ, he who has the Son has life. And he who hath not the Son hath not life. Acts chapter 26, 20 says, but declared first to those in Damascus and Jerusalem throughout all the region of Judea and then to the Gentiles that they should repent, turn to God, and do works befitting repentance. And what are works befitting repentance? The first act, the first thing we can do is baptism, the first work of repentance. It's a showing of everyone. I'm a believer in Jesus. It's a public profession of what's happened in your heart. Now in verses 4-6, we see a powerful word of prophecy. We see a declaring voice in verse 4 and 5. It's a voice of a prophet. He's quoting the prophet Isaiah in verse 4, as it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, saying, it's a voice of a prophet. Numbers, the 12th chapter, verse 6 says, then he said, hear now my words. If there is a prophet among you, I, the Lord, make myself known to him in a vision. I speak to him in a dream. And so we see that John, as a prophet of God, is quoting the prophet Isaiah, who was a very good man to quote, because he also, Isaiah, spoke of him. And so we see in verse 4 and 5, the latter part, a voice of preparation. The Bible says, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, every mountain and hill brought low. The crooked places shall be made straight, and the rough ways smooth. We see a declaring voice. And finally, we see a discerning voice in verse 6. A vision for mankind's salvation. In verse 6, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. All flesh means all the Jewish people and all the Gentiles. And so we see that even in the time of Isaiah, he's speaking of the Messiah coming, not just for the Jewish nation, but for the whole world. And we see the vision of mankind's salvation. Folks, we have a Jewish Savior. We have a Jewish Messiah. We, when we receive Christ as our Savior, when we receive the Messiah as our Savior, we are engrafted into the olive tree. We are brought into the Abrahamic covenant. The Bible said that he told Abraham, I will bless the whole earth through you. And that's what he's speaking about, that the entire world can be engrafted into the olive tree. And so we see, beloved, we are spiritual sons and daughters of Abraham when we receive Christ. And then we see a vision of mankind's Savior, the salvation of God. And who is that salvation? Jesus. In fact, his name means God's salvation. Isaiah 52:10 says, the Lord has made bare his holy arm in the eyes of all the nations, all the Gentiles, and all the ends of the earth shall see the salvation of our God. Folks, listen, Jesus has been preached throughout the entire world. There are Christians in the Philippines. There are Christians in Africa. There are Christians in Korea and North Korea and South Korea. There are Christians in communist China. There are Christians in communist Russia. There are Christians all over the world, in Central America, South America. I've been on many of the places all over the world, and everywhere I go, I find Christians. Why? Because he is the salvation of all the nation. So we see a discerning voice. We see John the Baptist today. He's the focal point of our message. In Matthew chapter 11, turn a little bit to the left. In Matthew the 11th chapter, we'll close with this verse. Matthew the 11th chapter, we'll start with verse 7. Jesus is hearing that John has been placed in prison. That John is asking, are you the one? Are you truly the one? And Jesus says to the people, gives this wonderful word about John. And he says in verse 7, and as they departed, Jesus began to say to the multitudes concerning John, what did you go out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken by the wind? But what did you go out to see? A man clothed in soft garments? Indeed, those who wear soft clothing are in king's houses. But what did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I say to you, and more than a prophet, for this is he of whom it is written, behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before you. Now, the book of Matthew basically talks about this. Matthew was one who was one of Jesus' disciples. He could have seen this happen himself when Jesus spoke to John about John. We see a voice of presentation. John the Baptist introduced people to Jesus. You know, and that's basically what we are today. We are like John the Baptist in that we introduce people to Jesus. And then he is a voice of prophecy. He had the credentials of a priest, but he had the calling of a prophet. Oh, beloved, the prophets have spoken out. And you and I, who share the great prophecies of the Bible with people, we too can be like John the Baptist and share the prophecies of Jesus' second coming. He is coming again, folks. He is coming again, and we need to be ready for him. Oh, beloved, it was a time of trouble. It was a time of turmoil. It was a time of tragedy, but it was the right time for John and Jesus to come. Let's pray. Hi, my name is John Blair, and I have the privilege of being the pastor here at Coventry Baptist Church in Fort Wayne, Indiana. I want to thank you for choosing to take part in our online services. I sincerely hope they were a blessing to you, and I want to invite you to continue to use them in the weeks yet ahead. In fact, take your time on our website, check it out, let us know what you think about it. Your opinion is very important to us, and we'd like to have some feedback. Let me take this time to also extend an invitation to you. If you don't already have a church home, let me invite you to come to our church and take part in one of our weekly services. Our morning worship service on Sunday is at 10 a.m. Our Sunday night service is at 6 p.m. And our Wednesday services and our midweek service is at 7 o'clock p.m. We're located at 10926 Aboit Center Road. We're right across the street from Homestead High School. Just get on our website. We have a detailed map and some instructions on how to get here. Again, thank you for choosing our website and our services. I pray that the Lord will bless you and keep you. I hope to see you this Sunday.
Blessed be the Lord.